can't see my beautiful face. Unfortunately, my wife decided for me to shave my beard, so therefore I'm not allowing anyone to see my face for at least 3 to 4 weeks. No, I'm kidding. On a serious note, I've got kind of a inner ear infection, and I get kind of lightheaded, so I'm gonna stay off my feet as much as possible for the next couple days, so you guys just get to hear my beautiful voice today. So we're going to get going here. I've got kind of a short lesson for you today. We're going to finish up the historical prophetic of Sardis, and Derek's going to have a few things to say about Luis de Molina and middle knowledge. But we will go ahead and get started here. We are still in Jesus's letter to the church at Sardis, and I promise you we will finish historical prophetic today, and then we'll have one last class next week to go over some final notes and some final takeaways so we can walk away from Sardis with our PhDs. We're calling this the Church of the Living Dead. Jesus said, "I know your works, that you have a name, that you are alive, but you are dead." Those are very serious words that we have taken extremely serious through this series, so we'll have some good takeaways here. Real quick, by means of review, once again, we do believe these seven letters lay out church history in advance. Jesus put them in a specific order for that reason. Now we can look back in what we would believe as the last days, vastly and quickly approaching Jesus' second coming. One of the reasons we can tell he's coming quickly is because of the accuracy of the historical prophetic outline. So now we're looking at what happened from 1517 to 1648, which was known as the Protestant Reformation. So with that Protestant Reformation, we looked at the two fathers of the Reformation, Martin Luther and John Calvin. We looked at the good and the bad, and everything in between with these guys. We also studied the Anabaptists and what they stood for. Next, we went to the Reformation of the Church of England, where King Henry the Seventh, Eighth, sorry, King Henry the Eighth, created his own, we'll call it an English Catholic Church that still stands to this day. Finally, we had the Protestants and the Puritans. I'm sorry, the Puritans and the Pilgrims, though they aren't exactly the same. They aren't unanimous. They're very similar, but they decided to break free from the Church of England. Felt more reform was needed, so we checked them out. Last week, we looked at this time of global advance that was happening during the Reformation when the Roman Catholic Church was sending missionaries throughout the world and what it looks like for missionaries to enter a new land and whether they should enter that new land through force or through love, and we talked about the differences between those. Finally, we got to the Jesuits last week, the secret society within the Roman Catholic Church, as some people would call it. The first black pope here in this picture was Ignatius Loyola. So, yep, you'll have to go listen to last week if you want to know about the Jesuits. But finally, we left off with this Jesuit. His name is Luis de Molina. He is probably one of my favorite theologians, so no one can accuse me of hating Roman Catholics or not thinking Roman Catholics are saved, because arguably one of my favorite theologians of all time is Luis de Molina, and you guys will get to see a little bit more of him today. He was a Jesuit, and he believed Christians committed their lives and surrendered their possessions to do Jesus's will. What a radical thought. He didn't believe that you could just have intellectual knowledge. He wanted relational faith. He wanted a relational aspect to walking with the Lord. He would have been closer oriented with Catholic mystics, believe it or not. He did believe in once for all justification at conversion, which was a radical thought at that time. He's considered the founder of middle knowledge. And as we did last week, we're going to delve into a little bit of middle knowledge here. And even Derek's going to give some further remarks than I can give. But Lewis was neither mainline Catholic nor completely Protestant. So he was actually right in the middle. He protested and wrote against all the things that he felt was wrong within the Roman Catholic Church that needed reform. He also believed that sufficient grace was offered enough to all humans to be saved. So he was definitely against Calvin's idea that only some were chose to heaven and some were chose to hell. So he literally walked that middle ground between Catholics and Protestants, as well as Calvinists and Arminianists. He didn't hold to the classic Arminian view of middle knowledge. We talked about that last week, and perhaps Derek will delve into that a little bit more this week. But Molina believed God chose the created order that freely saved some and freely damned others. There were circumstances that could have been chosen into which you would have been lost freely. That's a very sobering statement to think about. For whatever reason, God chose this created order that we all are amongst right now, and those of us that are saved should be extremely thankful, because there was potential for us not to be saved, and potential that God would have left us in our sins had we rejected him. But what's amazing is we would have rejected him freely by our will, but for whatever reason, he chose this course in love. And Derek will talk about that. Here's a few quotes that really kind of summarize Molina's thoughts. Remarkably, Molina believed that this face value reading of Romans 9 was entirely consistent with human free will. By the way, Romans 9 is one of the most controversial chapters in the Bible. It's what most Calvinists default to point to the fact that man has no free will. Because Molina viewed no possible individual as bad enough so that she or he would freely spurn God's grace in every conceivable set of circumstances, and no possible individual as good enough so that she or he would freely embrace God's grace in every conceivable set of circumstances. God's possession of middle knowledge, logically prior to his making any decisions about this world, including who would be saved or lost, provides the key to God's sovereign individual predestination. Wow, that's a mouthful. Derek will break this down for you a little bit, but Molina continues on here. Thus, in summary, for any possible individual, God has the power to elect, save, that individual by creating her or him in certain freedom-preserving circumstances where God already knows she or he would voluntarily embrace his grace. And God has the power to reprobate or condemn that individual by creating her or him in another freedom-preserving circumstances where God already knows she or he would voluntarily spurn his grace. And God has the power not to create that individual at all by actualizing other circumstances where the other individual does not exist. The choice of circumstances leading to salvation, condemnation, or non-existence is unconditional by anything about the individual, but depends solely on the sovereign will of God. And I'll let Derek break that down for you. Now we can understand why Molina would ask which God is more sovereign. When comparing his concept of God with Calvin's concept of God, just as human ruler who skillfully accomplishes his goals through the free choices of his subjects is more powerful than a dictator, so Molina found a God who can choose whether creatures possessing absolute freedom are saved or lost, strictly on the basis of his good pleasure, to be more sovereign than a God who can only determine their salvation or condemnation if these creatures lack absolute freedom. What a true statement. I think that Molina's interpretation of God's sovereignty is absolutely greater than Calvin's idea of sovereignty. So wrapping up Molina here, some concluding thoughts on him, another set of interesting facts here as to why Molina fascinates me and how he was so far ahead of his time. He stressed a very literal reading of Scripture. As you guys know, I prefer a very literal reading of Scripture as much as possible. He believed any creation without knowledge of Jesus could still be saved by placing faith in, quote, God and following the natural law in their hearts. By the way, I bring this up because this was the hot topic of the day. How many of you guys have had the question, well, what about the tribes in Africa who've never heard about Jesus, right? That's one of the number one questions that gets asked in apologetic studies. So just so you know, Molina believed that those tribes, even if they had never heard of Jesus before, they could still be saved by following the natural law in their hearts. So I'm not saying that I agree with everything that Molina teaches. I just once again think that it's very interesting that that was a hot topic of the day. And he builds a very interesting case. I'll say that. A very interesting case, and he builds it on Romans chapter 1. So I'm not going to get into that today. It's a whole nother topic. But just interesting that once again, during this age of global advancement, this was a hot topic. He was an early advocate for private ownership of property, and he believed you should live on what you need, not more, not less. But this idea of private ownership of property was a really big deal, especially in this time. So he was also what you would call an early advocate for a free market economy. This guy was so far ahead of his time. What's amazing is when you read his autobiography, when you read his biography, you learn that he used scripture to build cases for private ownership and for free market economy, versus, you know, the big government owning everything and a non-capitalistic society. So very interesting. He believed in separation of church and state. Once again, those who really got scripture understood that a separation of church and state was necessary. The church can never use force to gain converts. Wow, that's a radical thought, especially from a Roman Catholic. And his idea of libertarian free will played a huge role in all this. Once again, he believed so passionately that man has free will that he completely understood that you can't force a person to convert, period. So that was one of the reasons why he didn't believe in killing people who disagreed with him, because he believed that you have a choice as to whether you accept God's grace or not. And if you didn't accept God's grace, he didn't kill you for it. So once again, a man of his time. He taught the state had no authority to persecute people of any religion and should protect their ability to worship as they see fit. This guy was a leading forerunner, a front runner in the religious freedom that we all enjoy today. And he also thoroughly opposed the African slave trade, one of the originals to speak out against that. So an amazing man, Luis de Molina. I highly recommend you guys study him out. And he's becoming more and more popular because this idea of Molinism seems to be gaining interest. So finally, wrapping up the historical prophetic here, we come to what's called the 30 Years' War, which lasted from 1618 to 1648. It's the culmination of all the preceding battles between Catholics and Protestants. So this whole Protestant Reformation, this was like the war of all wars. More than 8 million casualties. This was a big deal. It devastated entire areas of Europe. Pretty much drew to a bloody stalemate. So this is kind of the summary of the Reformation period. Both sides kind of were fully exhausted, and they had lost so many lives, and they both kind of just realized that this isn't going to go anywhere. So the Roman Catholic Church had to kind of give up the reins, as they say, and realize that the Protestants and the Calvinists, they aren't going anywhere. So a treaty of peace was necessary, which brings us to the terms of peace called the Peace of Westphalia. This reflects the passing of an age. Calvinism joined Lutheranism and Catholicism as a recognized expression of the Christian faith. Princes, if they chose, could for the first time allow Protestants and Catholics to exist within their territories, and the Pope was excluded from any interference in the religious affairs of Germany. Naturally, Pope Innocent the, whatever that is, Derek, 20, condemned the treaty, but both Catholics and Protestants ignored his protests. After more than 1,000 years, the state was free to transact its business as though the Pope did not exist. What a radical time it was. Christianity's alliance with power, including its barbaric results, going back to Constantine, was crumbling at last. The modern age separating faith from regimes was fast approaching. Once again, guys, notice that. The state church really began way back with Constantine, after the persecution of the early church, when he made Christianity the state religion of its time. And unfortunately, when he made Christianity the state religion, a lot of truth in the scripture became muddied and lost, to be honest. And it's at this time during the Reformation when a lot of this stuff finally came back to the surface. So that brings us to this ending war here. Notice that in our church history there, this ends, a lot of theologians who hold to the historical prophetic view end it at 1648, and they end this Reformation period with this treaty. So what exactly was this treaty? It ended the 30 Years' War. It was a series of peace treaties over many months, effectively ending Europe's religious wars. 194 states were represented. It basically helped create sovereign individual states. Once again, guys, in the age we live in, individual states work a lot better than huge conglomerates. Once again, this idea of globalism and this idea that, oh, we can all just come together, it never works, it's never worked, and it never will work, because man can't handle that kind of power. How do you regulate who decides what is culturally acceptable? How do you regulate what is spiritually acceptable? How do you regulate what is economically acceptable, right? Who gets to make those decisions for the entire world? And unfortunately, scripture points to a time when there will be an attempt at this next new world order, and it seems to be forming on our horizon. The prospect of a Roman Catholic reconquest of Europe vanished forever. Protestantism was in the world to stay. It wasn't going away. So that kind of wraps up historical prophetic. I just have a few concluding notes for you guys. The Reformation produced great intellectual consent to the truths of scripture, but no life flowed from it. So think that through for a second, and we'll talk more about this next week. But you can get everything right in your mind, okay? You can know perfect doctrine, but if you're not applying it accurately, no life flows from that, okay? So this Reformation can be seen as a baby step. They definitely did great advancements in breaking free from some of the corruptions and some of the false ideas that had happened for over the last 1,000 years due to the Roman Catholic doctrines. So it was a good baby step. There was still a Nicolaitan separation. Remember, Nicolaitan means basically a clergy-laity split. Okay, so although Luther and the Reformers really, you know, were pioneers in getting the Bible to other people, they still didn't believe that the laity had much to do with the Bible. They still believed there should be a priest class and that only certain preachers and teachers could understand the word, and the laity were just basically to check in, do their two sacraments, go to church, and check it off a list. So there was still this Nicolaitan separation that never went away. The Reformers compromised on the truth of the Lord's Supper. So the Roman Catholic Church taught that Jesus was literally in the body, literally in the bread and the wine. Although the Protestants didn't believe this, they kind of met in the middle, and they call it consubstantiation, where they say that Jesus really is there, but it's in more of a mystical sense. When, once again, we believe that when Jesus said, "Take and eat, do this in remembrance of me," we're not literally eating Jesus' body and blood. We are doing this in remembrance of him as a ceremony. Although there are spiritual benefits to it, Jesus isn't physically present in those sacraments. Infant baptism retained, which preserved the deadening effect. Infant baptism, all that does is it deadens Christianity and it creates dead Christians, and we'll talk more about that next week. The Reformation produced one militant amillennial church in place of the Roman Catholic Church, minus the Pope. So, once again, amillennial believes there's no literal 1,000-year reign of Christ. So, these guys, all they were was another militant amillennial church, meaning they tried to set up the kingdom on earth through the Reformation, through reform. They thought that they were setting up Jesus' kingdom on earth without Jesus. So, once again, same idea that the Roman Catholic Church had. They just didn't get back to proper eschatological understanding. So that kind of wraps up the historical prophetic. And I look forward to next week to wrapping everything up and getting our takeaways. And I'm going to prove to you guys that the historical prophetic view is true. It fits. So we'll go over that. I love you guys, and I'll talk to you later.
So if you guys remember last week, Chuck was talking about Luis de Molina, and he's Spanish, so it's Luis, not Lewis, like Chuck says. But Chuck said, give a few sentences on middle knowledge, because that's like his claim to fame, the middle knowledge. And of course, like, this is a very complicated study. I've spent like 4 years studying it, and so I know how, like, it took forever to wrap my mind around a lot of stuff. So I'm like, how do I give a couple sentences on all that? Like, I even saw your guys' face last week when I was explaining it, because I'm like, you can't do it in a few sentences. So hopefully me mapping it out like this will help. So just to go over this real quick, most theologians will say that God, okay, so there are tenses to knowledge, meaning like logically prior, like God has this knowledge and then he has this type of knowledge, so forth. It's for the most part undisputed God has two. They say the natural knowledge and the free knowledge. So natural knowledge, this is before God ever creates anything, right? So in eternity past, God has natural knowledge, and that is his knowledge of all necessary truths. Like, God knew that he was omnipotent. He knows that he is all-powerful. He knows 2 plus 2 equals 4. Everything that has to be true, God knows just as part of his being. And the way that we could apply this to the discussion of mental knowledge, God knows what could happen. So in eternity past, God knows what he could create. So before he ever created anything, he knows every possible world he could create. Does that make sense? All right, and so then you get into the free knowledge. This is, once God creates, then his free knowledge comes into play, right? And like I said, this is like, there's a few Christian communities that would kind of dispute this a little bit. We've talked about open theism before, but setting that aside, most people agree God also has free knowledge. This is all contingent truths. So this is God knowing everything that is true because of his creation. Or in other words, God knows everything that will happen. That you can think of that as foreknowledge. Everything that will come, will take place, God knows that, right? But he also knows like everything that happened in the past, like everything that had to do with his creation. Okay, does that make sense still? Okay, so for lack of a better word, right in between these two, right in the middle, you have middle knowledge. Middle knowledge is all counterfactual truths. I know that's a weird word, but it's the only word that really fits. Essentially, it's you can think of it as kind of like hypothetical truths, or if this, then that truths. So think of your free will as a person, right? So God knows what would happen, and that's talking about what we would freely choose in a given circumstance. So Kathy, he could say, if Kathy was in this situation, she would freely choose this. Does that make sense? So, but he knows that for everybody in every possible situation they could be in. Anybody getting lost yet? So everything that would happen. And to me, like, you can get into really robust philosophical debates and kind of flesh this out. I've kind of been getting into that. But it just makes sense to me that God would know that. Like, some people dispute that. They'll say it's unnecessary, or they'll say it doesn't make philosophical sense. But I mean, it makes sense to me that God would know something like that. Like, why couldn't he know what you would freely do in a given situation,
like,
right?
If you won the lottery, you would buy a new car. Like,
yeah, exactly. Exactly. God knew that if I was placed in this circumstance I was, then I would teach this class. Something like that. You guys understand that? So I that makes sense to me. Remember, natural and middle knowledge happened before his creation, and I know it doesn't make sense to say before creation because that's when time came into play, but you guys get the idea.
Okay. You've got no creation between NK, which is natural knowledge, and middle knowledge, mm-hmm. but yet after middle knowledge, you've got creation.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand.
That's whenever he creates the universe, right?
But you've got no creation up there.
Well, because, like I said, it doesn't make sense to say before creation, so we'll just say there's no creation. Because creation is when time came into existence, so there is no before time. It's just without time. Think of it that way. So without creation, no creation.
But God existed before creation.
Exactly,
so
yeah.
So that's why you're saying that.
Right, so kind of think of this as not chronological, but logical. Which is another thing to wrap your mind around, but I won't get into that right now. But just to let you guys know, Molinism at its very basic level is not a theology, it's a philosophy. It is an attempt to reconcile God's foreknowledge, his perfect foreknowledge, with our free will. So Because if you really get into it, think about it this way. I've said this in class, but this was like 2 years ago. By the way, today marks 3 years that I've been in this class. So, if you guys remember, like I didn't come in until a few weeks after the class started, but yeah, it was the first Sunday of October. So, but yeah, this was like 2 years ago. I talked about it. Like, let's say God knows that you're going to eat Cheerios for breakfast tomorrow, right? Mm-hmm. Can God be wrong? No. So what are you going to do? Tomorrow you're going to eat Cheerios. But does that mean, like, could you choose otherwise? It's like, well, if you could choose otherwise, then you would make God wrong. But God can't be wrong, so you're going to eat. So some people look at that and they're like, so you have to eat the Cheerios, right? Because God knows that. But middle knowledge, whenever you throw that into the mix, it allows God to say, like, before he even created the universe, he knows if you were in this situation, you would freely choose that, right? So it's not that he's determining it and then foreknows it. It's he knows what you would do in that circumstance, so whenever he creates it, then he foreknows it,
but if that makes sense.
Would it help maybe to understand that bracket you put there for no creation, if you brought that over about halfway and came down with it?
What do you mean?
To where like, that you're...
Are you saying this?
No, on the other one there.
Right.
No creation. Your line afterwards that comes down after mid-creation.
Yeah.
If it came down like in the middle of mid-creation.
Are you saying like this comes...
Yeah, because the middle creation is kind of a carryover into the creation.
Right. So yeah, no, I see what you're meaning, because that can open a whole other can of worms. So I'm making sure to keep this as simple as possible. Just
I'm sorry.
No. It's
just not simple.
Because yeah, we could go there, but no, you're right. But yeah, like I said, so that's why. So Calvinists and Arminians, they'll typically say they'll take out the middle knowledge, right? And so a Calvinist will say in God's natural knowledge, he determined a world, then he created it, and because he determined what happens, he foreknows it, right? So that's where his free knowledge comes into play. Whereas Arminians typically, not always, but typically they'll say that God has his natural knowledge, then he creates the universe, and then he looks, like through his foreknowledge, looks down and then kind of builds the world that he wants through that. The problem is with the Calvinists, you know, you have the whole free will issue. And with the Arminian, the problem with that is that if God is looking into the future to see what's going to happen and then plans, you know, accordingly, then it's not really foreknowledge, because foreknowledge is what will happen. So if he's looking at something that will happen and then changes it, then that wasn't actually foreknowledge, right? That's where middle knowledge comes into play, because it's like, oh, that was actually a hypothetical, like a possible, you know, thing that could happen. So that's why the simple foreknowledge Arminian, we don't really subscribe to, and the Calvinists, we don't typically subscribe to because of the
free will thing. It kind of reminds me of the multiverse theory, where they say that anything that could happen, like a million choices you could make, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when you make one choice, that's what's happening here, but according to that theory, in another universe, you made another choice, you
so,
know what I mean?
Yeah, so take the multiverse theory and say, well, the multiverse doesn't really exist, but the idea is God's knowledge of every
possible
world.
That's how I look at it. In the multiverse theory, but as far as God's knowledge, he knows every possibility that could ever happen, and there's a million possibilities to every situation.
Yep.
But he also knows what out of the million, that one that you will choose because of your heart,
Exactly.
You know what I mean?
And so there's two components to Molinism. We'll call it mere Molinism, right? It is that mankind has free will, libertarian free will, and that God has middle knowledge. That's Molinism right there. So you see, I know Arminians who are Molinists. I know of Calvinists. Alvin Plantinga is a big time philosopher. He's a huge subscriber of Molinism and middle knowledge, but he's also a Calvinist. And then it's just a philosophy that kind of aids your theology and understanding the relationship between God's foreknowledge and our free will, right? So anything Molina says, like theological, that's just him trying to extrapolate from his idea of middle knowledge, trying to build theology with that, if you understand that. So that's why we can disagree with some of his theological positions. You know, Chuck was talking about, like, what about people who don't ever hear the gospel? Like, what happens to them? Like, Chuck doesn't necessarily, and I don't necessarily agree with that. You know, it's something worth fleshing out sometime. But the idea is that, you know, you can take the free will and God's middle knowledge and kind of put that into your theology to make sense of it all, essentially. But, you know, whenever you talk about the biblical authors, I don't think they had any of this in their mind. They're just taking it like, here's the truth that God has inspired us to write.
And then, you know, they were okay with that. But then you get to the Enlightenment period and where we need to understand everything, you know, like flesh everything out philosophically. That's whenever you get into this kind of stuff to try to make sense of it all. So does anybody have any questions regarding
this? It's tying to salvation in a way.
Well, and that's one of the things where you can, you get into the realm of speculation, like why did God actualize this world with the circumstances that, you know, that are going to come into play? Why did God do this one instead of a different world? You know, it's all for speculation. You know, come to your own understanding through scripture to just kind of see, you know, flesh it out. Some people, I'm not even going to get into it. So there's so many different ideas.
What about things like war? I mean, you know, if you're in a battle and, I mean, God has knowledge of who's going to die and who isn't in that battle. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you really don't have free will in a combat situation or in a battle. Or, you know, for thousands of years, people have been having wars. And, you know, does he know that every spear that's going to hit someone and kill them, he knew that they would choose that situation to be in?
Right.
Wow.
Yeah. So in other words, like,
he's working everything out for our good in the end. He has a plan. He already has the plan planned out. See, so that in the end, he's working bad things like war into the good of the final destination that he's trying to achieve in the end.
Right. Yeah. So,
some things are necessary that are bad, like war.
Because of free will. Exactly.
Wow, yeah.
So like this can get insanely deep. So
it gets deep.
But anybody got the time right now? 9:50. Oh, okay. Well, any real quick questions? All right, I think
everything that happens, God has a reason for.
Mm-hmm. Exactly, because he knew the world that he would set up before he ever created anything. Mm-hmm. And Alvin Plantinga once said that the Christian gospel is not only the greatest story ever told, but it's the greatest story that ever could be told. So just in my understanding, I think the world God actualized is the greatest of all possible worlds, essentially.
It's kind of confusing, but free will, I mean, if he knows that you have free will, but he knows you're going to make the wrong choice for the right choice, that's not really free will.
You see, and that's where you're getting into because you're trying to understand, like, how does it relate? And I mean, like I said, I can flesh it out, but I don't know if it'll makes sense, but essentially God knows what you will do in any situation, or what you would do in any situation. So whenever he knows you will be in that situation, he knows what you would freely choose to do. And so he can kind of rearrange, he can arrange things to account for your free will decision.
Well, I know in scripture it says he punishes us like a father, and I know that happens.
Yeah.
And is that because we didn't follow what he knew we was going to do?
Yeah. But he didn't make us do it. Is the X factor there?
I mean, I choose to praise him because it's my free will. Did he know I was going to do that?
Tyler always has a good. You know, Tyler Hood. He got a good analogy that he a couple years ago he set up here. He was like he told this story about like you're going to choose God or you're not. You're going to say yes or no. So here was a guy that chose yes, and here was a guy that chose no. But they were going to the dinner banquet. For God's dinner banquet, and so God already knew this guy would choose no and this guy would choose yes. So when they got up there, he asked him, "What do you choose?" And the guy said, "I choose yes." And the other guy says, "I choose no." So when the guy went into the dinner banquet that chose yes, he sat down and he looked, and there was his name tag already set a place for him because God already knew he would choose yes. But then he looks over and he was like, "Well, where's my buddy's place? What if he would have chose yeah?" But God already knew he chose no, so God never even made up a seat for him.
Whoa.
So he already knows what you're going to choose before you even choose it.
Hopefully
that helps. But he lets you choose it then.
Yeah.
So it's just like that, I guess.
He lets us think we're in charge.
But I think one of the things Molina stresses that I would agree with, because there are things I could tell you that I don't agree with him on, but it's kind of a peripheral thing. But one thing is that God offers sufficient grace for salvation to everyone. Like, whereas the Calvinists say he only offers the irresistible grace to those he wants to elect, that he chooses to elect. Whereas what we would believe, and Molina believed, is God gives sufficient grace to everybody. Like, it's a legitimate offer. You guys understand that?
You can be an atheist and then change your mind and go on God's side because you have free will. You're an atheist, so you're always going to be an atheist. You can't do nothing but be an atheist, so you're not going to heaven.
Right. And so anybody who is condemned in the end is because they chose that. It's not because God didn't try to
God's
save
not
them
the author of bad.
It's not because God didn't give them the opportunity. It's because they chose that. So they get all the blame for their condemnation. God gets zero blame for it. But for everybody who comes to Christ, because God offered them sufficient grace, God gets all the credit for them coming, and man gets no credit for this salvation. So I think that'll do. Let's say a real quick prayer, and we'll get going. Heavenly Father, thank you for today, and thank you for this class. Just please enlighten our minds so that we can understand these truths that you've laid on our hearts. As Chuck talks about, this Sardis period, and we talk about Molinism and middle knowledge, that this can all make sense to us, and that we could search the scriptures to see whether these things are so. Real quick, Father, we want to lift up Chuck, because I know he's been ailing for a couple weeks now, so with his inner ear infection and everything, we pray that your divine hand of healing can be on him, that he could be restored 100% as quick as possible, Father, and thank you for our brother Chuck. And just please be on the pastor today as he gives a sermon. Let it affect our lives, and let us be able to take it out into the world and glorify your Son. It's in his name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
If you've enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.